Prusaslicer 2.6.1 has pegs. If you're thinking, that was ages ago, you're actually right. I kind of got bogged down with some other things. Anyway, let's look at the new stuff in this release, preferably before the next one comes out. This video is sponsored by PCBWay. More about that later on. You may notice that this is a thing now. We have a Mark IV in house, in room, on desk. I thought since Prusa have sent me a Prusa, I would show Prusaslicer on a Prusa. It's really hard for me not to say Prusa. It is pronounced Prusa. As per the filament box, look, see? It's not actually, it's just that's the closest I can do. I do multitask sometimes badly, so some stuff is going to be on other printers and not on the Mark IV, but I will soon be reviewing this or something similar. I put a poll out and I'm sort of not sure what to do because obviously reviews on Prusa machines are quite evergreen, so that would be something that would probably do really well, but at the same time I would like to do something technical on it, so I'll probably end up doing both. Anyway, this machine will be sticking around on the table because, as we all know, they just work. I've also pre-ordered the MMU3 for this. It should be out soon for the Mark IV. I will be making content about that, and that should be actually really cool. I'm looking forward to that because I've never had a MMU like that before. Waffling aside, the main thing in this release of Prusaslicer is, as I mentioned, pegs, or as the official name, snap connectors, which, I don't know, I suppose is more appropriate, but for some reason when I wrote the script I decided to just call them pegs, so yeah, let's just go with that. I suppose you might not know about dowels, which I think were new in 2.6, because there was a lot that was new in 2.6, so it might have got drowned out in the tree organic support that everyone was excited about then. Splitting models is not new, but putting pegs on them is new. Prusaslicer's UI is really good on this in terms of the splitting and the placing of the dowels or pegs or whatever. You can cut a model anywhere you want by moving the plane around, and you can rotate it on any axis, but you can also draw a cut, kind of like Fruit Ninja, but for STL files. Yes, so I'm spending the next 5 minutes just cutting things in half. Oddly to me, while I like these pegs, I see them as less useful for my sorts of things. For example, one of the reasons I might use dowels is if I want to print something like the fox here, supporting this would make the belly side ugly. So you can solve this by cutting it straight down the middle, using dowels, and each side can then be put down flat. In the last video, I used a companion cube, which has no flat sides. Cut it in half, use dowels, and then you can lose no detail. Hopefully I'll get a clip of that. So, to my mind, pegs are more aimed at things that are taller than your print bed or wider, you know, won't fit one dimension. So, it's for height or size issues rather than support issues. So it's for making models bigger than your printer can cope with, and it's a really good way of doing that and being able to join the pieces together. One half therefore always has to be pointing upwards effectively, unless you want to dice with supports and pegs at the same time, which is, yeah, it's not a good idea. So pegs allow huge models to be printed on smaller printers, and there's no limit to this, and if you're into that, that will be good. Do they work well though? I don't like to print large test models for, well, it's a waste, so I will scale it down a bit, but the pegs remain the same and therefore the test will be equally valid. And yep, they do work. They are prone to snapping if the pegs are small though, so I would make the pegs as chunky as the piece affords you, within reason. So use all the space you can and make nice wide pegs, and that will work best in my experience. One interesting side effect of this that comes to mind is that this is a way of multitasking between printers as well. If you break a larger print and stick it on multiple printers, I did a this on the half the rocket engine. I put half the rocket engine on the CR10 SE and half on the Prusa. And it seems fine, and this is a testament to modern printers being well calibrated out of the box. Both of these printers have not been calibrated by me, I just put them down and started printing. This definitely would not have worked a couple of years ago without a lot more effort. There is also, in this section, a new dovetail for this release. This is admittedly cool, but I am struggling to see a great deal of use for it. It is implemented really well with real-time visualization of the joint, so you can't really go wrong if you want to use it, because you can see exactly what you're doing. I don't really know about this. Do you see a use for it over the other methods? I guess it's a reusable connection, maybe. Either way, it's there and it's cool to play with. If you have used it or you can think of a use for it, let me know in the comments. Before we continue, yeah, no segue this time. It is too hard to try to dovetail PCB manufacturer with FDM slicing. Yes, that was a segue. I want to take a moment to talk about this video's sponsor, PCBWay. PCBWay are, of course, PCB manufacturers, and I want to show you the process of the PCB that I had manufactured with PCBWay. I think last time I had just received it, I've now populated it, and it works fine. It literally works completely, totally fine. There are no errors in my PCB design, so I'm quite impressed with myself. So I can show you now what I meant, I guess. There's default connectors for things on the side, anything you want really. You could just use the screw terminals for just about anything. These go to the GPIO pins on the ESP chip, so you can just address them in the program. But if you want to redirect these screw terminals to another port, you can remove the jumpers, and you can do so with a simple jumper cable. You can tap straight into the connectors themselves if you prefer to do that. I don't know why this stuff isn't more popular on prototype boards, because it solves a lot of the issues that I have with prototype boards, but there you go. That is what I made, and it is going to be in a video very soon. Ordering PCBs like this from PCBWay is super simple, that even someone like me can do it. All you have to do is simply design your PCB. It's a 5-minute job, I assure you. It's not. And then export the files and upload them to PCBWay's quick order page. Very few options needed to be changed by default unless you want something specific. I would suggest picking a colour, checking the shipping time. Different colours have different manufacture times, so that's how I ended up with green. It was the quickest. Complete the order and then sit back and wait for a surprisingly short amount of time. Turnaround can be pretty quick, unlike the turnaround time on my videos. Don't forget, PCBWay also do 3D printing and CNC services, among others, so you can get custom parts printed in things like metal if your home FDM isn't going to produce a strong enough part, or maybe things like nylon if you just don't want to fill your house with fumes. Thank you, PCBWay, for sponsoring this episode, and back to the next section. So, arranging parts on the bed is the next thing on the list. Arranging parts isn't new, of course, but there has always been this annoying phenomenon where if you have a large thing and then you have small things, the arranging function won't see the gap that's in the large thing, if there is one, and that's usable space, and that is now fixed. It's not as niche as you might think either. I've come across this problem a non-negligible amount of times before. Of course, the solution is to move the part manually, but it's nice that it can now do that itself. Even if you have the space around an object, it doesn't mean that you want to use that part of the bed. It's quicker to keep everything in the middle, and generally printers perform better in the middle of the bed too, for reasons beyond the scope of this discussion. So that is a cool improvement, even if you do have to go hunting for the right options. I'll tell you in a minute. If the Prusaslicer development team want any more challenges, then a funny extra idea would be to apply this concept in three dimensions, like so. The options I'm using here are accessed by right-clicking the Arrange button, and of course you need to set the spacing quite low to see what I'm seeing here, and that is fine. Printers don't mind low spacing. I'm not sure why the defaults were quite so high as they were. Also, honorable mention to Shift A, That's Shift A, which will let you arrange only selected items. The key for arrange all by default is just A, so Shift A is for selected items, A is for all items. You could deselect items on screen by holding Shift and clicking on them to do what I'm doing here. So you can do Control A, select all, and then Shift click on the items you don't want to rearrange, and then Shift A to arrange the ones you've got selected. I'm sure that is completely confusing. I'll put it on screen to try and make it a bit clearer. If you want to know all the keystrokes for Prusaslicer, you can get them on a t-shirt, upside down. It's in single player mode. Nice. I know what my printable's points are going towards next. Probably filament. Next up, you can now define your own bed shape. Do you have a print bed that isn't round, square, or oblong? Me neither. Is Prusa releasing a printer with a bed this shape? I hope so. But seriously, if you want to define your own bed, you now can. I suppose there's some edge cases, pun intended, where you have spots on the bed or edges of the bed where you don't want to print. You could define that, but I just feel like it's looking for problems to solve. From my perspective, it seems like a perfect source of shenanigans. Where there's a feature I don't know the use for, I usually find a way of exploiting it. So, who knows? Maybe there's a future video there. But there you go. Text on stuff has been improved on curved surfaces. It doesn't distort now, apparently. I seem to remember having trouble with that when it first came out. I don't want to get into the math of it, but it looks like it assigns a normal to the curved surface for every character in a text string now. And bear in mind that curves don't just mean circles, it could be the whole of a benchy. This is probably quite some complicated math. This is a checkbox that you need to enable, so nothing has been removed if you preferred it how it was. I can't think why you would, but you never know. Finally, multi-material stuff. There is an interlocking thing now with multi-material painted models. It's not like the interlocking in Cura that I mentioned in the last release, I think it was, where the parts actually do interlock, and that was a huge feature in Cura. I would have called this one interleaving, personally, so that it doesn't get confused with Cura's interlocking, but either way, it should offer better adhesion in some cases where the two materials are poor at mating. So that would be things like PETG and PLA, classically, or PLA and TPU, because both of those don't play well together. It should work fine, and I guess it's going to be rolled to certain other machines that shall not be named eventually that have multi-material AMSs, so it will probably be appreciated there too, if and when it gets added. There you go, that is it. You are up to speed with Prusaslicer, I think. Let me know in the comments what you think, as always, and it looks like I've got to go because I just noticed there's a new Cura literally just rolled out, and there is something really huge in there. So make sure you're subscribed. It is Slicer update season, apparently. I will see you next time. Thank you for watching.